हेलो।
I think there is some problem in connectivity. So it has got disconnected from the meeting.
So meantime, Neha, I think you can go ahead with the introduction of.
Yes, sir.
In case, please check the connection. In case the connection is right.
Yes, sir. So we will have Neel Chawla sir joining us in a short while, and. Before that, I would want to introduce our resource person, our keynote speaker for the day, for the session, Colonel Rajiv Bhargav. So your profile is just illustrious with the experience that you carry. I would just read a very brief profile of sirs to our entire audience. Colonel Rajiv Bhargav has done his post-graduation program in management from Indian School of Business in Strategy and Finance and had a Master's in Defense Studies from Madras University. He did his graduation at the prestigious National Defence Academy. Currently, sir is an associate director at the Munjal Institute of Global Manufacturing and Punch Lloyd Institute of Infrastructure at ISB, the two institutes set up with MIT as an associate partner. Sir has also co-authored in two working papers. Before joining ISB, sir has worked in the Indian
Neha, if the connectivity is the issue, I can continue with the same. Before joining the ISB, he worked with the Indian Army for 2 decades and commanded a battalion of over 1,000 troops. During his tenure as commanding officer, his establishment was conferred recognition for excellence in project delivery and his inspirational leadership. He was awarded the commendation card of General Officer Commanding Army Training Command. He has also been an instructor at the illustrious Army War Challenge and the Army Air Defense College. As an instructor, he taught strategy and operations to officers from Defense Forces of India, Sri Lanka, and Nigeria. Colonel Rajiv Bhargav is a prolific writer and has authored a book titled Perspective of Indians Defense Offset Policy, which was released by Defense Ministry of India, Minister Manohar Parikar, and he has also published in Economic Times, Mint Quality, India Publication, and other newspapers. Colonel Bhargava has a keen interest in design thinking and innovation, and he has been a resource person for the DST NIMAT sponsored faculty development program for the past 4 years. Sir, excellently, the profile is so illustrious, and definitely all they are going to get a lot of benefits with regard to the design thinking and the ecosystem which we are providing, definitely going to be a big way for number of institutions. I would like to request Sunil Chawla ji to say a few things, I think, in case the connectivity is right now before the start. Sunil Chawla ji, you are supposed to unmute yourself, I think.
Mr. Sunil Chawla, sir.
Sir, you can unmute.
Yes, sir. Sir, I think still there is some.
Okay.
Some issue in sir's connectivity.
So it means we can request Colonel Bhargava to continue with his talk.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Audible now.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible now.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Hello.
Sunil ji, you are audible to us. I think some connectivity issue is there.
Hello.
Rajiv ji, in case if you think, I think we can start till. Ji sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So I'm just sharing my screen now. Okay, so Dr. Rajesh Bagga. And all our fellow eminent panelists, amongst others, I thank you for this opportunity for you know, taking a session on design thinking in daily life. I feel the students of today are the future of the country, and if we can inculcate a few things in their mind, it will be a job well done by us. So thank you very much, and. What I would like to say to our students is that please feel free to participate, and the best way to participate is using the chat mode. So I am monitoring the chat continuously. So as and when required, you please, whenever there is a response required, please use the chat mode, and we will give you some ample opportunity to even have your, you know, to answer your queries as the time comes. So very briefly, what I can do is that I can suggest is this is the agenda. The basic of design thinking till 10:45 or so. From at 10:45, I have one of my colleagues, Mr. Mrityunjay. He's the global head for FRA Ops at Novartis. I will request him to join in for just about 15 minutes to give you an idea about how design thinking is taking place in the pharma industry. Thereafter, from 11 to 11:05, there will be a brief hands-on activity and a carry-home assignment. So why I'm calling it carry-home assignment is because in case time, I feel the time is less. And normally what we do is a workshop where, you know, you study in groups. So in case time is there, I will use that. Otherwise, it would be a, you know, home assignment. And then 11:05 to 11:20, we will cover the ideating and prototype, and thereafter it would be a roundup by 11:30. That is the agenda. So now let us come to the main thing. What is design thinking? Really, if you see, every product and every process around us has design behind it. It is immaterial whether the design is good, bad, ugly, or excellent, whatever it is, but every product has a design behind it. And what happens is that we as a human beings are constantly thinking. Imagine there is something behind every item. There is a story behind it. So what happens is that if you are able to even, you know, process your thoughts in a channelized way, imagine how much of output can be there, because each one of us is thinking. So let me come to the important point. See, I was happy. I sent a survey earlier to all these students, and I got around 80 responses. And the question that I asked was, are you aware about design thinking? And what you people answered is right here. 65% of you are aware, and 35% are not aware. Of course, by now, this slide is reached you. You are 100% of you are aware, because I have been told you design thinking, right? So. Very good. It's good to see that 65% being aware, and I'm sure we will put it to good use. So now comes the point, what is design thinking, right? A design thinking is a framework for understanding what the real problems of people are and finding solutions, very much so. And what if you will really see that design thinking has changed our lives in a big way. It has changed the way we people think, the way we enjoy our lives. That when you are in the bathroom, when you are, your eyes are closed, and that is the time when you are applying shampoo, normally it takes time, you know, that shampoo comes out, takes its time in coming out. But somebody designed it to be placed upside down. And it is always at the press, a slight press, the shampoo comes out. Similarly, you know, medicines. So you have those strips. Now those medicine strips, it is very difficult for an arthritic person to cut open that foil and do. So somebody designed a bubble. You press the bubble and that, you know, the medicine comes out. So these are all there are thoughts behind, design thoughts behind this. So actually, let me tell you that, you know, I my next question will give you some this thing. Before that, I would like to bring out that you have to be unprejudiced when you do your design. If your mindset is unprejudiced, it is open to everything. In the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities, but in the expert's mind, there are few. Very right. The experts are already experts in their area. So what happens? They are more focused. So whenever you, it doesn't mean that an expert can't design. What I mean is that whenever you approach a problem, approach it with a beginner's mind. Be curious and you will find that you will come up with solutions. I ask this question. Do you feel design thinking is difficult? 28% said no, whereas 30% said yes, and 42% said maybe. So this question, I just want you to put it in the chat mode. Why do you think design thinking is difficult? Just any one word, two words thing. Just put in the chat. One of those, a few of you can put. Okay, I don't see anyone putting in chat. Brainstorming. Acha, oh, you find brainstorming difficult. Anyway, so most of the people find design thinking daunting or difficult for the simple reason. They think that it requires somebody to be an artist, to be able to draw, to be able to make graphics. I want to prove to you guys, no, that is not the case. Every one of us has all the tools required to do design thinking. And I will prove it to you in the next 1 minute that it is so simple. Now, as I said, design thinking is all about, you know, being go with a beginner's approach. And for that, you have to be thinking out of the box also. Now, here is an example. There is this, you know, delivery van which is stuck. So there were all engineers around it looking to how they can extract it from under the bridge. And suddenly this boy came who was just, you know, loitering around. And he said, oh, what is the problem, sir? So they said, come on, you show off. You know nothing. He said, no, tell me the problem. They said, can't you see it? The truck is stuck and we can't take it out. He said simply, okay, sir, I have an answer. Why don't you remove the tire, the air from the tires? And it will be able to move. So see, out of the box thinking. And they would have otherwise done so many other things. But simple things work quite often and quite brilliantly. So now, I want to prove to you that you can draw. I'll request all of you to have a paper and pen right next to you. And I am going to say a figure, item, and you have to draw it. And you'll have 10 seconds to draw it. And I can assure you, you can do it in each 10 seconds, right? So let's do it. Take out your paper and pen and we start. Okay, the first thing I want you to draw is a baby. please go ahead. Okay, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 10 seconds done. Next, mountain. Draw a mountain. Again, I'm sure your mind is working. You're all designers. You're all thinking hard. Draw the mountain. Next, draw a house. Somebody has drawn it very fast. I can see people have done it. Next, draw the sun. Right? So you have drawn the sun, the moon, the mountain, not the moon, sorry, the sun, the house, the mountain, a baby. And then last, why don't you represent innovation by a figure? Well, I can now prove to you, after you have done this, that all of you can be designers. All of you are artists. All of you can draw. And I will prove to you. I'm sure if I say the baby, this is what you have drawn. Right? Most of us. Mountain. This is the mountain. House. I'm 90% sure most of you would have drawn a hut. Sun. And innovation. Now, I want to bring out a few things. I'm confident if you look at the sun, you won't find, you know, rays coming out like this. What you would see, you know, most of you would have drawn it, you know, the way I have drawn a circle with long lines and a short line, long line and a short line. Please confirm on chat if that is how you have done. If anyone has not done, fine. But most of you would have done that. Similarly, for a house, you would have drawn a hut. No one will draw a house. They all draw huts. And maybe to add to it, you would have added some, you know, birds like V-shaped figures. So that is what it is. A mountain, of course, this is it. And baby, you have never seen a baby with just two hairs, you know, two hair curling out. But I'm again confident most of you would have done this. So what is this all about? What I am trying to say is that drawing doesn't need expertise. What you need is the ability to convey your idea in graphic form to somebody else. If you can do it, your work is done. So simple. If you can do that, your work is done. So it's simple. A sun. Everyone knows, you know, there are some, as somebody has written in a chat mode, that we have been, from childhood, we have been conditioned to follow these things. And that is right. So use those things. You are all of you, each of you can be a designer. It is just that the requirement is, the tool required is a pencil so that you can convey your thought in a graphic form. I hope I've conveyed my, you know, what I wanted to, that you are, no one can, should feel that they can't design because they are not able to draw or convey their ideas. So let me just quickly go through some more insights from the survey. So I asked this question, do you keep getting ideas to improve things around you? And I'm happy to see that 90% of you keep getting ideas. Imagine every 9 out of 10 of us have ideas to improve the processes and the products around us. If we can even convert 10% of those ideas into products and processes, imagine the life improvement that would have taken place. An immense improvement would have taken place. Have you improved a product or a process in the last 6 months? 32% of you, that is 25, said that you have. 54 said they didn't, but I am quite confident that in the coming, after this session, the figures would be reversed. I would love to have a feedback from you. I'll be sharing my email ID with you people also. That if you have been able to convert something based on the tools and the ideas that I'm going to suggest going ahead, it would be awesome. And I asked you, what do you like best in a well-designed product? See, you are all, I have seen in the survey, most of you, 70% of you have less than 5 years of experience. And I'm so happy to note that if there is one thing in a well-designed product that you would like, it is that it should be highly functional. Now, that is a practical approach. Now, looking good, low priced are also important factors, but it should be highly functional. And you are on the right lines, let me tell you. Then I asked you, what do you like best in a well-designed process? Yes, 41%, 28 of you said that yes, it should be more efficient. Very right. Reduces effort, yes, yes, but then efficiency is the main thing where behind which the design, you know, design thinking affects the most. So some examples of products around you that can be user-friendly with time. Some products, they could be that, you know, remember the milk ATM, it always asks for coins. There are so much other problems here. Virtual classrooms today are the in things. Laptop, imagine laptop chargers. Man, half the weight of the laptop is in the charger. I mean, and I'm sure that I am touching a pain point in your heart. And these chargers are painful. And along with that is laptop batteries. Every manufacturer says, my laptop will run for 18 hours, 16 hours. what it does is 3 hours and then you are looking for a place to charge. I don't know what is this going on. Helmets, if you see, no one wants to wear a helmet in this hot sun. Why can't we improve the helmet so that it can be better? I know, I understand that it is, there is some amount of, medical reasons where the material has to be made in such a way, but I'm sure something can be come out. E-books, yes, somebody said e-books, but then e-books are also are coming up in a big way. Some of the processes, what have come out is availability of blue-collared workforce. Yes, then you can have an app which can, there are already apps there, but they can be improved upon. Then you have the single window, women entrepreneurs, managing recipe videos, airport boardings. Yeah, imagine a woman with three brats trying to, board an airplane. How much? Yeah, income tax returns. I mean, you people have not yet, I think, reached the stage. But ask the few who have already and they will tell you. It needs a lot of improvement. I mean, one is that you are paying to the government and then over that you are getting a headache in filling up the thing. I mean, that is atrocious. Online banking can be improved further, especially because the amount of hacking which is going on, right? You need to be constantly on your toes. So let us now come to the real topic, and that is of design thinking per se. We will come to some very important aspects as we go along, and you will realize that it is inherent in us. Design thinking is inherent. It is only that we need the right tools to start designing. So the basic thing which is there is, if you see the design cycle, it has just five components. That complete cycle has five components, and they are empathize, define, ideate, prototype, and test. We will see each of them as we go ahead. See, one thing I would like to bring out, empathize is a very widespread. You have to, you will come to see what is empathize, but it is very wide. Whereas when you define, you start focusing. Then when you ideate, you again clear up. And when you come to the prototype, again, you start narrowing down until this time you reach the test, cycle. And that is the time it is narrowed down to a large extent. So now I come to what is empathy? Empathy is all about, it is a very important portion of design. If you go wrong in empathy, then your design will never be, you may design something, but it will never be successful or popular. For popularity, empathy with your customer is the most important thing. Now, empathy is about, putting yourself in the other person's shoes. Now, suppose you are a boy or a girl, and you have a girlfriend or a boyfriend, all right? So you need to, now suppose you want to reach out to your mother or your father, so you have to put yourself in their shoe and see what will happen. If I go and approach with my girlfriend to my mother and say that I want to marry her, most probably she will immediately react. So put yourself in her shoe, then you see, why will she react? She will react because the girl very well, but here is somebody coming into her life and she knows nothing about her. So obviously she will react. So if you have put yourself in your mother's shoes, what you will do, you will start introducing your girlfriend to your mother even before you tell her that you want to marry. So maybe there is Instagram, you know that your mother likes Instagram or she likes Facebook and she likes the likes in those Facebook and Instagram. So your girlfriend can become her friend, start liking various, whatever she puts, whether good, bad, whatever. And then slowly, they come to know each other. And then when they, maybe for all you know, your mother will come to you and say, beta, why don't you marry this girl? She's very nice. So that's how design thinking and empathy is all about. You have to feel what the other person is feeling. And you need to balance the feelings and the logical thinking. Now that is very important. Half the designs have failed because the person who has designed puts his feelings, not the feeling of the customer. So how do designers approach empathy? One is without judgment. Do not go pre-judgment. Yaar, ye nathu jo hai, iske paas mein jaunga to ye to pehle hi mana kar dega. Ye to bikaar hai. So you will never go to that nathu. But the point is, you should keep going to Nathu. Maybe Nathu will refuse 9 times, but the 10th time he will say yes, and then you know things will work. So always reach out without judgment. Then go with a beginner's eye. I told you, you have to remove all biases from your mind when you approach any problem. We will see that as we go ahead. Then have a lot of curiosity. Now, the 3 tools are that can help you, in an unlimited way, are how, what, and why. Keep asking these questions and you will find some, very surprising answers. Be optimistic. Always think that the thing will work. Don't be negative. If you go with a negative view, what you get is something negative only. And then be respectful. By respectful, I don't mean say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, this, no. Just be respectful of the idea or of the requirement or of the need of the person for whom you are designing. Now, these are a few things which will help you reach out with empathy to that person. As I said, your mind has to be unprejudiced. It has to be open to everything. And you can train yourself to think that way. It is not that, you can't do it. You have to train yourself, remove all biases from your mind, and then do it. There is something known as an empathy map. Please note this. This is very useful for you people. Where when your customer for whom you are designing, maybe it is yourself only for all you know, or your mother, your father, your colleagues, or the general public. So whomsoever you are interviewing, you are going to see the 4 things, what that person said, what that person did, what the person felt, and what the person thought. I remember I was in Hyderabad and I was driving my car at that time. So I reached out to a person and asked him the directions for a particular place. Now that person, he didn't speak in Telugu. He spoke in English to me. And he said, "Yes, sir, please move. Go right." And on his hand, he's showing me left. He's showing left with his hand and telling me right. I went by what he said. I turned right. And sure enough, after 2 minutes, I was back at the same place. I wish I had seen his hand, which was telling me the other way now. So what a person says and what a person does, the body language, you have to, when you are interviewing that person, you have to see those things. So what you say is what the world is expecting you to say. What you do is something which comes out naturally from you. So if you are going to be a good designer later, please note, be observant. What that person felt is, of course, you can come to know by, questioning him. The why aspect and how aspect can be through the thought and so on. So many other things are there. Yeah, Harman, you are raising hand. I will come to that a bit later, if you don't mind, after this. Okay. Now, here is something which I want to bring out at this stage. In fact, Harman, if you have a question, rather than speaking, can you just put it in your in the chat box and I'll answer it right now, if you can put it in the chat box. Okay. So, here is an example of a good empathy, a positive empathy. The managing director of this company known as OXO, O-X-O, had his wife who was arthritic. And that, in the kitchen, that lady, whenever she was, making food and peeling potatoes, he used to see her suffer. So he decided that, okay, I will do something about this. And what he made was this, you can see the device on the right, with a big fat grip. And sure enough, that changed the way the ladies functioned in their kitchens. And this was just one little thought. Now, by the way, this is a very, very popular device which has come out. And people have appreciated it. And just because he was empathetic, he thought, he put himself in his wife's shoes and thought, ki kitna pain ho raha hai. So he designed this, this potato peeler. And that made a huge difference. So empathy is very important. You have to place yourself in the other person's shoes. And how do you place yourself? You place by interviewing them, you being shadowing them, being with them, following them, and observing them for a large period of time, maybe days if required. I'll give you another example. Okay. So you are an export firm, suppose. I mean, not you, maybe your client is an export firm. often requiring to connect with offshore clients, right? So the phone network is often patchy, as it is becoming quite often these days. And you must convey your contact details to the client clearly and in minimum time. So how will you select a suitable phone number? So what you do is you sit with the client's place and you see how the client calls the foreign and the, you know, the foreign customers and so on, and see and try and understand. So what you may find is that something like this, a number. So it is easy to say 9 followed by 9 zeros or whatever. But the problem is, you should, if you are empathetic, you will find that when you start dialing that number, you don't know where to stop with zero. It is very difficult till you keep putting zeros. You'll have to count 9 zeros or something like that. So it is not really a good number, right? Next, you can go in for something like this. By 01, I mean it, not just 01, it could be 02, 03, whatever. So again, there is a similar, the same problem. 01, 01, 01, you don't know where to stop. And last, whether there is a zero or whatever. So, I mean, this is simple, but it is not solving the problem. So maybe you will go for this. 922, 33, 22, 332, or whatever, right? Again, it is better than the previous, but it remains that you don't know where to stop your 33 or the 22. Then somebody may come up with this, something like this. 91234, 91234. This is, you can say 91234 and repeat. But the problem that may come is, you know, I'm just giving an example. The India's code is 91. So somebody may start thinking the number starts with 234. And what may happen is that you will never, ever, that customer will never come back to you. You lose a customer. So maybe something like this may work. 97531, 97531, repeat twice or something. So this is just an example that I'm giving you. There may be a number of options. Then there are those VIP numbers also. There are those religious numbers also. And there is no end to things. But this is just what I'm telling. If you pay attention, maybe you will find the pain points that, you know, somebody for whom you are designing, that what that person is feeling. So this was as far as empathizing was concerned. Let me come to an equally important aspect. And once you have empathized, how do you define? Right? Define is that narrow angle, right? I said, as you can see, design is the narrow. You are focusing as you are going to define. Not design, sorry, define. In define, you are focusing. So what is to define? You define by converting empathy into needs and insights. Yeah. So somebody has told you, okay, that this is what I am, problem is or whatever. So you have to put it into needs and insights. So you have to have a deep understanding of the user and producing an actionable problem statement. We call it a problem, we'll come to that, called POV, or the point of view. This is the point of view which the designer has ascertained from this customer, right? And a POV can be consisting of three things. You please note this. I told you to note one thing previously. I'll just show it again. That was this empathy map, very important. You can note this. This comes very useful in getting to the POV, right? Next is this to define. You define by converting empathy into compelling needs and insights, I told you, and then the POV. And in POV, who is the user? You need to define. Is it a young, forward-looking woman? Is it an old, physically disabled, retired man? Is it a bodybuilder ready to conquer the world or whatever? You have to define that. What is the deep unmet need? See, the unmet need is very important. What that person may tell you is not his need or her need, right? The need is lying somewhere else. You have to be very, you have to get that need out of that person. That is where your real design thinking goes. And then you have to come up with why is it insightful? Whatever, that need that has come out, what is the insight that you are getting from that? And this is the complete empathy, need finding process. Now, if you can achieve these three things, you will find that designing becomes very easy for you, right? So as this is, I have covered, needs are human physical and emotional necessities. And these are the goals and motivation of the person for whom you are designed. And most important, needs are verbs and not nouns. These are opportunities and not solutions. I will come to this. Now you tell me, you can chat, put it in the chat mode. What do you think this girl needs? Quickly, put it in the chat mode. Book, stool, tool, book, book. Okay, fine. I think most of you are saying that she needs is a book. Okay. So if she needs a book, what you can put is give her a stool and she will take it the book. Right? That is a noun. A book and stool is a noun. What if I say that she needs to reach out? Rather than saying that she needs a book, I say she needs to reach out. What happens? Now you have got a number of options available. You can give her a ladder. You can give her a stool, or you can give her a chair on which to stand. You can give her anything. You see the difference. When you say she needs a stool, you are limiting your options to just a stool. So you as a designer will only think of a stool, right? Similarly, now what happens is that she, when you say she needs to reach out, that's a verb, then you have got number of options available. There is another very good example, say lawnmower. What is the, why do you need a lawnmower? What is it that you want? You say that I want to, you know, have a well-maintained grass and a manicured lawn. So you need a lawnmower. So you'll always have a lawnmower for that. Now the requirement is that what you need is finally that your grass should always look good and it should be well-maintained. Maybe somebody will then go beyond a lawnmower and come up with something like a more bio seed, which will ensure that the grass doesn't grow beyond a point. I'll give you a very famous example. When Henry Ford, he asked people, you know, who were riding horses, and what do you want? Suppose he asked people, what a person would have said, I want a faster horse, right? But thankfully, Henry Ford did not just listen to them. What is actual need of the person is to go faster from place A to B. Now, if that person says, I want to go faster from place A to B, there are a number of options. You have a car, you have a scooter, you have a horse also, you have anything. Imagine if he had listened to them and said, faster horse. So today, we would have had only horses around us, for all you know. You see the strength, the power of understanding that your need has to be a verb rather than a noun. So now we come to insights from the needs. The insights are the question why response to the need. They are capable, they are the capacity to gain an accurate understanding of someone or something, right? It is to connect the head and heart of individuals, head and heart. And you know, what happens is insights reveals what the inner feeling of that person is. And that is how that, from that why it comes out, you know? So in fact, what I can tell you ask why 5 times to a person and you will get so many insights that the person may start crying. And here is a live example I can tell you. See, in one of the workshops when I was a student, we were told to design a man's wallet. So I was the designer and my person was the customer, the person with me. So I asked him, bhai, tereko wallet kaisa chahiye? He said, I want a fat wallet. I said, why? He says, I want to carry more notes and I don't want to carry, credit cards. I said, why don't you want to carry credit cards? He said, because I am afraid of unlimited liability that can come through those credit cards. I said, why are you afraid of unlimited liability? He said, my mother told me that you are the worst bump as far as money is concerned and no one can trust you. Now I stopped there. Had I asked him further, why does your mother does not do that? Then he would have, you know, put his head on my shoulders and started weeping. I didn't want to go that to that stage. But what I'm trying to bring out is that the question why is a very, very powerful tool. It will get you what the person really wants. Now, for example, if you see, Steve Jobs, I mean, you can't have a lecture without the Apple being discussed in that. If we had asked the customers what they want, the people like us, we would have said a better phone to, talk more clearly, right? And we would have had that only. He was able to know that what we want is a device which can enable us to do multiple things in a much faster way and blah, blah, whatever. So he was able to design something which was, at that time, we wanted inherently, but we were never knowing to spell out. You see the importance of that. So now the point of view will have three things. Now this equation, you should be able to, keep it very well with you. And it is the user. You have to have a user, you have to have a user's need, and you have to have an insight. As far as possible, the more surprising the insight, the better would be the design. By surprising insight, I mean something which that person even didn't know that he really wanted. For example, now suppose there was this Pallavi wishes to eat ice cream at unique places. Now, if suppose this is a point which has been found out. Now, if I say Pallavi, after interviewing her, of course, if I interview Pallavi and I discuss with her why she wants ice cream, why this, why that, and all those whys I ask till she stops crying, it will come. Pallavi, an energetic teenager, wishes to eat ice cream at unique places, right? So eat ice cream, this is the need. But now comes the insight, because she feels being cool is more important than the taste of the ice. So the user is Pallavi, an energetic teenager. The need is that she wants to eat ice cream at unique places. And the surprising insight is because she feels that taste ko to rehne do, I want to look cool. Having ice cream at some, in the same, some wherever, I don't want to reach that this thing, right? So now you have understood that. So from that point of view, what we now get is a how might we, So what you have got an insight. See, first you were interviewing that person. So that person gave you some needs. Those needs you were able to make into verbs to get more options. And you made a point of view. And from that point of view, now you will say, how might we? I'm making it HMV because HMW may, that flow gets affected. So I made it HMV. So this is a very, very powerful question in design thinking. It is the, somebody had raised a point that, the why they are afraid of design thinking is because there is brainstorming involved. Yeah, so this will enable you to brainstorm with a purpose. It is the seed for ideation that falls out of your point of view. So from the point of view, you can find the, when you design a process or a product, the HMV will decide for you whether it is a success or a failure. So for the POV, and again, you can have a number of narrow, broad, optimal changes. So for the POV, that Pallavi, an energetic teenager, wishes to eat ice cream at unique places and this thing, the HMV can be, a narrow HMV would be that how can we design an ice cream that does not drip, right? How might we? It's a very narrow this thing that you are arriving that, okay, what we are doing is just designing and so the taste may change or whatever, but it will not drip. A very broad would be how might we redesign that is usko ice cream ni kuch aur de do. Okay. I mean, that is also a way that go beyond ice cream. You can give her something, whatever. Then is optimal. The optimal would be maybe how might we redesign the ice cream to make it more portable so that, Pallavi can carry it anywhere. And as far as possible, the taste has also not changed and you can use it in the right way, right? So maybe the designing, the redesigning the ice cream is very important. Now I come to a very, very, very interesting aspect. Yes, I'm telling you it is very interesting. Suppose you are the owner of an office building and your tenants are complaining about the elevator. They say it is old and slow and they have to wait a lot. So several tenants are threatening that they will move out if you don't fix the problem, right? So the problem is the elevator is too slow. Solution is maybe make the elevator faster. And how can we do that? You see, so the problem, as I said, tenants of your building wishing to have the elevator replaced as it is too slow. The insight is that tenants want to commute faster. Is it that they want to go faster? If that is what they want, then you replace the lift with a faster one, or you change the motor, or you tweak the algorithm. So these are all, you know, costly stuff. So how can you find another way? Is there another insight? Is there any other insight? Okay, there can be an insight. So what if the insight is not about commuting faster, but the tenants are annoyed with the wait? When they are waiting, they are looking down, looking up, looking at the person in front of you. Okay, kab aayegi lift? And that is the problem. So if you can change, if you can reframe your problem, it will change the entire solution. And what can that solution be? And this is a, let me tell you, this is a tried and tested one. In reframing, what they do, they put mirrors next to the wall. When you put a mirror, the person tends to lose track of the time. And one is, you know, because he is or she is watching something very fascinating, which is themselves. So what you have done, you have found a very sophisticated and an elegant solution to the problem. The problem is that the elevator is too slow. That was what you framed. And you found a solution. When you say it is too slow, you find a solution that make it faster. But on the other hand, if you say the wait is annoying, then you find a different set of answers. You put mirrors, play music, install even some hand sanitizer, let him keep rubbing his hands or whatever. So, and I told you this similar problem was, you know, as a youngster, you want to introduce your girlfriend to your mother. So if you if the problem is that mother will react, then what you do is whatever, you know, you may take your girlfriend and, you know, coach her that when mother shouts, you listen and this and that and so on. But on the other hand, if you reframe the problem as that the mother wishes to know the girl better before that girl is thrust on her, then what you are going to do is introduce them to each other much earlier, even before the, you know, the when you propose. To a mother that I want to marry her. You get me? So that is how in your daily life also, please frame and reframe the question. See what the person actually wants and you will find solutions which are much more elegant. So this is one very interesting how might we, HMV as we call it, very interesting. Suppose the POV is a harried mother of three rushing through the airport, needs to board quickly. As a wait at the gates will cause her annoying little brats, those annoying little brats, to irritate the already frustrated fellow passengers. So how do you redesign the ground experience of the people? So one way could be, HMV could be, use the kids to entertain the fellow and, you know, fellow passengers. So make the kid jump around, put a trampoline out there, the kid keep jumping on the trampoline and the, you hope that the others would be you know, enjoying. Or maybe separate the kids from the fellow passengers. You can put a sort of PlayStation somewhere on the side where the kids can go and play. But the problem could be that when you have to really board, the kids will say, I won't come or whatever. Then could be explore the opposite, which is how might we make the wait the most exciting part of the trip? Or a question on assumption. How might we totally remove the wait time? So the mother of three may be asked to board the plane, but then for that, the plane has to come. I mean, in India, you know, the things are so delayed that the plane itself will not come. So how will you do that? Then other is go after adjectives. How might we make the rush refreshing instead of hiring? Imagine giving them a soft drink or something or a burger or whatever. So what happens? These guys, the children get, they enjoy. Then there could be a very, very different, unexpected way. That how might we leverage free time of fellow passengers to share the load? Now, if you can achieve it, you are a great designer, a wonderful guy with the fellow passengers, you know, playing around with the kids. Or it could be create an analogy that how might we make the airport like a spa or like a playground, right? Put those small football fields there where the children can play. Or play POV against the challenge. How might we make the airport a place where the kids want to go? So they will not be brats. Or how might we make playful loud kids less annoying? Maybe put louder music on the side So the kids shouting doesn't affect. Or it break it into pieces. How might we entertain kids? How might we slow our mom down, right? Or how might we mollify those delayed passengers? I mean, it could be anything for that matter. So the idea is HMV is a very important, you know, piece of your entire design that opens up vistas for you. So the road, if I may bring like this, is like this. Empathy map. You make the map. What the customer said, what the customer said, what the customer thought, what the customer felt. Then you are going to identify the need. I told you it is a verb, not a noun. Achha, one thing I would like to bring out very important, that whenever you are interviewing a customer, I would recommend you should go to the extreme customer, by the extreme user. By extreme, like for example, I told you about that CEO who designed something for his wife, right? He potato peeler. Now that wife was an extreme user, right? Because she was using it day in, day out. So that you come to know the real problems. Like Twitter, for that matter, let me tell you. Initially, there was nothing such as a hashtag. So Twitter found, they reached out to some of the people who are heavy users of Twitter. And those people said that we find it very difficult to find things. It is very difficult. So then, based on discussion, Twitter came out with the hashtag. And that solved a lot of problems for all of us. So you have to reach out in your empathy if you can find an extreme user. If not, I mean, obviously. Then I said, identify the need. This is interesting. In fact, when you are going to people, I have been doing these workshops and I have been finding that people come out with such interesting stuff. You know, last time, I was conducting this workshop for a group of PhD and faculty and about 40 of them. I asked them, okay, design for me a carry bag. And what they said was, you know, very interesting that a carry bag is something which you don't flaunt. You don't carry it in your hand. What you need is something which can come to the purse. I agree. But what really, I mean, was struck me was when they said that a carry bag should have multiple purposes. Imagine a carry bag which can turn into a raincoat when it rains. It becomes so much more useful. I mean, that same raincoat can become a carry bag by a zip, moving of a zip or something like that. So what I am saying is that make it a verb. Not a noun. If you say a noun, then you only get a stool. If you say a verb to reach out, then you get a number of options available to you. That is, and then this is very important. And then from that, you can make insights. Now, what a person really wants. You know, there is another one which I would say. There was this young girl who her parents wanted that she should have nutritious food, which is, you know, very distinct, which is good for her and so on. But they never thought it from the girl's point of view. What the girl wanted was to gel with her crowd. Now, if the crowd is having a burger, the girl is not going to have something, you know, sprouts or something like that. So the point was how to make sprouts that something which gels with the culture in which she is in. So maybe, you know, that that soya beans turned into soya chaap and so on. So these are some of the thoughts which are there. Then make insights. Ask the question why and keep asking that why till you come to know the real reason why a person wants. He may say just that, or she may say that I just want a fat wallet. But why does that person want a fat wallet? And if you can identify that, maybe that person may not need a wallet at all. Because if that person is afraid of unlimited risks, so maybe what you can do is give them something like a Paytm, or where you have a limited risk, They can use Paytm and there is no fear of risk. So why have a fat wallet? You see, you've changed the requirement totally by just asking why. Then framing of the POV, the framing of the POV is user, users, needs, and the surprising insight. So the HMV is formed on the basis of the POV. The POV is the most important equation, if I may use the word equation, because it sounds much more romantic, but yeah, equation. So user needs to do what? That is the need of the user. Because why does that user want to do? Now that will give you a number of options to design. So you may ask the HMV, how might we? And that HMV can launch your brainstorming. That is how the things work most of the time. Okay, now next we come to ideate. You have done the definition, now we come to ideating. Ideating is again flaring up. It is no more focusing, it is flaring up. So ideating is all about your design process in which you aim to generate design alternatives for the same. The goal is to provide, explore a wide solution space where a large quantity of ideas that you get, and you can then finally shortlist a particular idea. And how to brainstorm? One, I have already spoken enough, defer judgments. Don't prejudge. Don't say ke natthu jo hai wo ta jawab nahin dega, no hi karega mere ko. Don't do that. Go for volume. Have large number of ideas. The more, don't reject any. Let ideas keep coming on a particular thing. Then one conversation at a time. Only talk of one issue. Don't talk of 10 issues at the same time. Be visual. Make graphics. I told you are all graphic designers. I've showed you. Be graphic. A picture is worth 1,000 words. And a graph is worth 1,000 pictures. This I have added, the last one. I mean, that was never there. But I have added that a graph is worth 1,000 pictures. Set a time limit always. Otherwise, there is no end to it. There are people who will keep giving you funny ideas. And when it comes to execution, there is this thing. So you have to be there. Then build on others' ideas. Don't cut down others. The tendency is, it's a frank truth I'm telling, even I do it. When you are in a group of five, somebody gives an idea, and you say, nahin, nahin, ye toh bilkul theek, ye nahin ho sakta. Hum aise karein. So the moment you cut off an idea, maybe you are cutting out an excellent option that may be coming. Then stay on the topic. So one conversation at a time and be on the topic only. Don't start off and you start on some ye motorcycle kaisi hai. You start on a motorcycle and then you say, ke mere ko yaar, main le nahi gaya motorcycle ke upar aaj tak. And then you start talking about Leh. No, you have to talk about the motorcycle only. And lastly, encourage wild ideas. The wilder the idea, the more encouraged. You see the Jeff Bezos of our times, right? The Elon Musks of our times, and all the Branson of our times. When at some time would have said, we will have a commercial vehicle which can take tourists to space, people would have laughed at them, I'm sure. Ye kya idea lekar aa raha. And today, they are becoming successful commercial ventures in the times to come. So now, ladies and gentlemen, I have with
me. Excuse me, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to inform you, yes, Mritunjay sir has joined us.
Right, I've seen that. You are just WhatsApp me also. I saw that. Thank you. So yes,
We welcome you, sir. Mritunjay Singh ji is Global Head of Innovation and Continuous Improvement FRA Operations Navratis. Sir, thank you so much for joining and sparing your valuable time for us.
Yeah.
So, thanks, Dr. Rajesh. My pleasure.
So Mritunjay and me have been classmates at ISB. And ever since, even there, he had a flair for designing. And his way of thinking is way ahead of all of us. So Mritunjay, I won't take much time. I am now starting your slide. Okay? Could I?
Sure. Thanks, Rajiv. Hi everybody, I'm Mrityunjay Singh. I'm based out of Hyderabad, and in my organization I head innovation for the finance operation. Now, like any other business owner, business process owner, or a product owner, they always want to bring innovation to improve their product or process or services. I am responsible for helping them improve their process, but as a owner for innovation, I have to innovate the way we do innovation. And that's where I, like many other in the industry, used design thinking for improving our innovation. Rajiv, if you can go to next slide, please. Yeah, so what you're seeing over here is like my attempt of showing you how design thinking has changed the way we innovate. Now, traditionally, innovation was all about, how do you bring scalability? And that's where you will have Ford Motors assembly line. So that point of time, innovation was, you make something and then you find a way to make it cheaper, higher in volume. Now, what has happened in this digital age, it's easy to scale. There are so many different ways in which you can add value to the customer. So now the crux of what is a good product is not something which can be scaled, but it is something which add value to the customer. So we are very, very customer focused now. And that's where the design thinking comes into picture. I'll give you a very small example how traditional innovation used to work and now how design backed innovation or design thinking backed innovation is changing the way people are innovating new product. Now, let's say I'm looking at the upper process flow, the process flow which is on the upper side of the graph, the design. So traditionally, if you want to make a product, what you'll do, you'll make a very solid business plan or a product feature plan. You'll spend most of your time on that. And then you will convince your management or the sponsor or the investor to invest on the idea. He will invest. Then you will kind of bring resources together and you'll make your first prototype or a first few prototype. And then you will take them to the customer. And then you will get the customer feedback. Now, this is where the challenges will start hitting you. You have made a product and you have sold it to customer almost at the fag end, just before going to market. Now, if a big feedback comes to you, you will have to either leverage your marketing, brand it, position it, and hope that the customer would like it, or you have to go back and start it from the scratch and then build it again. Now, that's a very expensive way of building a new product. Now, when you do the same thing with design thinking, you will first take the idea and you will iterate it. You will try to build a small prototype or proof of concept, something which is just working, and then you will show it to the customer. They will give you input and that input would be incorporated. Then you will again show it to them. Then they will again give you input and then you will show it to again. And when the final product would be ready, there are so many time the customer has given its input that it's like you're co-creating it along with the customer. Now, when you co-create, you have taken all their input. So you are not going to surprise the customer. Even if there is a small change, the way you have designed it is in a very iterative way, you can always make the changes. So that's a very fast, keeping customer at the center, and less cost of going wrong is very less in this. So that's how design thinking is changing the way we innovate. That's like a comparison how innovation has evolved due to design thinking. Rajiv, I don't know what's the format. I mean, if anybody has any question, can they ask now or at the end?
Yeah, they can ask. That's fine.
So maybe I'll pause here for a moment. Anybody has any question or anything they would like me to elaborate upon on traditional innovation versus design based innovation? Okay. Then what you're seeing on your screen is how we actually do it in the industry. It's a very high level, but detailed enough for you to know what are the key steps which adds value to the entire innovation process or the process through which a new product or a service is designed. Now, the first big box you see is persona. Now, that's very important because that's when we know our customer. Now, we work for one company. So what we have done is we have developed persona independent of whatever they are going to ask in future. So at any point of time, we know that if a request is coming from a order to cash team, we know that, you know, who these guys are, what are their priorities, how do they operate. Similarly, if it is coming from, let's say, travel and expense team, we know what are their pain points, etc., etc. So persona is a very, very important step. You know your customer, and then you start, you know, designing it for them. And this is the reason why most of the companies ask you to, you know, have your app installed in your phone. They ask you to, you know, log in whenever you want to interact with them. All they are doing is, you know, they are building their knowledge base of knowing you better. And over a period of time, collectively, they will have so much information about you that, you know, they can design a product which you might not even know that you want it. Then the next step is around a problem scenario and alternatives. Now, this is where you start to flare the picture which Rajiv was showing. You don't focus now, you expand, you look for alternatives, and then you look for, you know, how this problem can be solved in a non-traditional, non-intuitive way, if you can. Then you go to the value proposition and assumptions. So this is where you kind of start working on, you know, what solution can come in. You will pick few, and then you will take it for customer, how would they perceive it. Now there will be a feedback, that's the red loop. You keep doing that till the time the prototype or the product is approved, okayed by the customer. And once it is okayed, then you scale. It might look like a very repetitive process which will delay the delivery, but what happens is you know, whatever experiment you are doing, you do it very fast. You do your POCs at a very low cost and in an agile way. And once the product is ready, then you scale up. And that's the last point. So this is how the innovation is managed, and then you keep experimenting and yet keep the cost of, you know, putting a new product out low. So that's how a typical design thinking process we follow. I'll again take a quick pause. If anybody has any question, please feel free to ask. Okay, we'll go to the next one. Now this there are two examples which I took out, which will help you relate with, you know, how design thinking can change, can bring in business, new business to you. Now the first one is around a medicine, a tablet, which now it's getting 3D printed. So that means it's like a dispenser which will give you medicine as per your requirement. Now what it does is it makes it personalized. That means, you know, I don't like big pills. For some reason, I have a phobia against it. So I can have smaller pill. I'm a kid. I'm not happy with the taste of the medicine. But if you give me in a heart shape or a star shape, you know, I would like it. And then, you know, this is no brainer that, you know, if you like the medicine, chances are that you will take the full course of the medicine, and that will help you heal. Then there are patients which require very specific doses. For example, if a doctor wishes to give a patient, let's say 3.5 mg, and the medicine only comes in 2 mg and 4 mg. Now, there is no way you can precisely cut an existing medicine tablet. That means all the time, either patient is getting an overdose or an underdose. Now, with this 3D printed medicine, you can be that precise. For old patient, now, this is very important. They sometimes miss the medicine. So you can actually print the name on the medicine that this is Tuesday, this is for Sunday, Monday, Wednesday, so that they won't forget it. One of the big cost of taking out any medicine is prototyping. Now, that's the medicine which is used for clinical trials and all. Now you don't need to use your factory to produce a prototyping medicine. That's a very expensive way of, you know, making those prototypes. 3D printing can be of a good help over there. They can churn it out faster because not big machines would be involved. The last point is like, you know, because of design, you are bringing in new customer. Now imagine there's a blind patient, and he would never be able to know, you know, when he's taking a paracetamol or when he's taking a, let's say, a painkiller. Now, if you have a 3D printed medicine with a braille engraved on top of it, he can start using it. And anybody who develops this medicine, they are actually, you know, catering to a need of blind patients. Similarly, for people with, you know, less cognitive abilities, you know, you can have a color or a day pill, a different shape, a night pill, a different shape. So suddenly, you know, you have catering to a need which was never fulfilled. So that's one example how design thinking is going to change the way medicines are, you know, consumed and produced. There is one more example I have from the industry. Rajiv, if you can go to next slide. Yeah, so this one is a very, very revolutionary way we are, you know, tackling how to treat a disease. It's called cell and gene therapy. Now, traditionally, medicines were like, you know, you take them and then it will go mix into your bloodstream and then it will go and you know, find the place where, you know, the disease is and for which it is designed, and then it will try to cure it. Now, that's the traditional way of, you know, treating. Now, what cell and gene therapy does for the specific cases where the problem is coming from the defaults in the gene, these medicine go and treat that like a small correction which can be done, and that means the disease will be cured from the root. These are very revolutionary, and an example of that is the SMA patient, you know, the 16 crore rupee medicine which was in the news. That's an example of cell and gene therapy. So that's another way, you know, a very specific customer input can be taken into account, and you change the way you kind of service the same requirement. These two examples I had from the industry. I can now take a pause and then, you know, open for any question or any query.
In fact, Mrityunjay, what I would like to bring out is what you just now said and what I have talked to them earlier. One thing is that be it any type of industry, like even pharma for that matter or others, the basics of design thinking, the design cycle remain the same. Like you developed a persona, then you identified the need of what the patient is, and then you design based on that need. You have come to that how might we design a medicine for someone who is blind. How can that person be able to get the right medicine and so on? So what are your comments? Don't you think it is the basics remain the same in whichever industry you may go?
I agree. I mean, that's the beauty of design. I mean, it's not restricted to one industry. People are using it in gaming. People are using it in, you know, how you interact with your software. They might call it different name. They might call it UI UX when it is about, you know, the screen you're interacting with. The people are even using it in FMCG. Even the malls are designed, you know, keeping in mind, you know, how a customer will interact with the product kept on the shelf. So yeah, absolutely agree. Maybe the names are there, but the underpinning, you know, requirement is to identify what customer want and service them.
Right. So yeah, so I think thank you very much, Mrityunjay, for bringing in an industry perspective to design thinking, which is often lacking because people like us, and especially the students, at times they do not have the opportunity to see what the industry is doing. So I think you have brought in a very important aspect, and I definitely can assure, I mean, I'm very sure that Novartis is going to gain a lot by your experience and your insights, and we hope to see even many more medicines and or some innovations which have worked on with based on some design thinking, particular design thinking by you.
Thanks, Rajiv.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mrityunjay ji. One question, I think, may I ask?
Yeah, please.
So definitely when we are talking about the innovations and continuous improvement, the costing is also to be involved, means for your existing products. So how you are able to manage with the cost management and all that? I think you are doing the innovation and continuous improvements in case of finance. So the cost will be a big element. How to manage with the help of the design thinking in case if it is possible?
Yeah, so this is like a very valid practical challenge which we face, you know. So there is a way you innovate. Continuous improvement is fine. You find small things and you improve upon it. But the moment you bring that, you know what, we are going to try out 4 or 5 options, the first question which comes in, you know, we have a budget constraint. That means if you want to do it, you have to find a way to do it in a lesser cost and faster, because they have a time constraint also. And that's when we try to create a different team who does this prototyping or innovation, and a different team who does the scale up. Now the team who does prototyping and all are like frugal thinking, so they will not use let's say a big SAP or a .NET based tool. They will use Python, Alteryx, the one which are like, you know, very quickly you can put them together and try it and then dismantle if it is not working. So in short, this is a challenge. What we do is we reduce the cost of doing experimentation by using cheaper alternatives and you know, involve team who are more agile, more like a entrepreneur mindset versus the IT team who kinds of scale it up. So that's how we manage that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, if there are any questions at this stage of whatever I have covered so far and whatever Mrityunjay has covered, you are most welcome. You can put it in the chat mode. I'm monitoring the chat. Anyone? Any questions so far? Okay, the question is that we see some logo, website design, etc. How we think it is better for client?
Rajiv ji, sorry to interrupt. In case if you can mic bit closer to your mouth, then it will be more fine.
Yeah, sure. So I think Harman Singh has asked a question saying that sometimes we see a logo, a website design, how we think it is better for client. Harman, can you just elaborate further what your question is?
I think they're trying to ask that how design thinking can be applicable in designing logos or websites.
Very right. Yeah. Mrityunjay, you want to take a shot?
Yeah. Sure. I did marketing as major at ISB. So yeah, I would love to take that. So logos are very, very, very strong asset of any company. Now, if you design a logo which appeals to your values, and you're able to communicate this to your customers, I think you're going to have a strong bond. And that's why you see the good logo designer are paid very high. And what they do, they make multiple designs. They have, like, you know, typical flaring up. They will have so many options on the table, and then they will go out in the market and they would like to understand if this is a good representation of what my brand wants to communicate and customer are able to receive. So that's how they use design thinking over there. Now, website is a combination of a user interaction also. So if you make it very user friendly, the customer won't mind spending time over there. I can give you an example. Now, if you go to a typical news website these days, you will see, you know, you try to open up news to read and you'll have advertisement coming from left, coming from right, coming from top. Sometimes you'll say, okay, not worth it, and you'll move out. Whereas you go and see a same, you know, setup on LinkedIn, same setup on, let's say, Pinterest. It's so beautifully placed, and none of them are, like, you know, crowding others area. So you don't mind spending longer time over there. So that's how you can use good design thinking in website designing.
Yeah.
And I don't know, Rajiv, if you want to add.
Yeah, I can add something and see.
Excuse me, sir.
Harman, please go ahead. Harman, you have a question?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Sir, sometimes customer ask me, I want a, like, sports logo. Okay. So, what we think about how to design, how to create?
Yeah, Harman.
They give me only task sport logo.
Yeah, fine.
Yes, sir.
I get your point. So the what you have to do is follow the same process. And that is empathize with that person who wants that logo. See as to why that person, you know, interview that person. See what the person speaks, what the person feels. What are they really wanting to do? Like, the Apple logo, if you see, right? It is an Apple.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Frankly, it has got nothing to do with mobile phones, that logo, right? It has got nothing to do with digital, this thing. What it does is that bite of an apple is all about showing that you have desires. You have some, you know, very major, very, you know, deep desires that we may have. So a bite of that. So Apple enables you to achieve those deep desires. And that is why that bite is there. So that sports logo that you may design may not have any sports item in that. It may be about achieving excellence. I'm just giving an example. That person may be wanting to achieve excellence in this field of sports. So how do you define excellence? How do you show that? And that is why these designers, logo designers, are paid so much, because they are trying to ask why, till they arrive at what you actually want. And they depict that through a graphical form. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Anyone else before we go ahead? Okay, thank you. Mrityunjay, we will really not take more of your time. Thank you so much for these inputs. And I'm sure this young lot, these, you know, most of them are less than 5 years of work experience and they are students and so on. They will get an idea as to how, you know, design thinking, even in industry, how people go about doing it. And that would give them a fair idea. Thank you so much for your time, Mrityunjay, and you're always, it's a pleasure interacting with you.
Thank you so much, Mrityunjay ji, and definitely we will love to have you in our campus along with Rajiv sir, whenever the things will be better. And thank you so much for sparing your time, sir.
Thanks, Rajiv and Dr. Rajesh, sir. It's a pleasure. Thank you. Have a nice day ahead. Bye-bye.
And we continue. Meanwhile, so the next what I want to show you is, we had this design practice. Basically, what I was thinking was that if it's a workshop, it would have taken you around 1 hour in which you would have worked and then you would have made your presentations. But I'm sorry, but I don't think we have that much of time. So what I see, what is the work that we have? The task that I have for you is to design a mineral water bottle for an on-the-go salesperson. Use and throw. I'm sure you all have been using mineral water bottles. And they are definitely lacking in design to a large extent. So here is an opportunity for you to come up with something. What I know, ideally we would have put you into breakout groups of 10 each or 8 each. One of you would have become the customer or the salesman. 8 of you would have grilled him and found out what is it that he or she really wants. And then based on that, you would have taken your steps. Now what I would do is, because of paucity of time right now, let us just, I'm sharing with you a format on the basis of which I will request you to come up with your thoughts and share that on email with me. I will surely respond. You can do it in the, if it is possible, if you are a homogeneous lot, then you can do it in study groups and send me. Or if not, you can send it on an individual basis. Now, what I would want you to do is, if you are the individual yourself, I mean, ideally, that is not good. You need to have another person as your customer. That works better. So you describe the individual, what type he is, an on-the-go salesman, whatever that person is. Then what are the things that he or she is wanting to do? I mean, here it is drinking water, right? And how does he want to drink water? What are the, once you ask questions, you realize what I'm saying. Then what are the ways or he or she feels while having the water? What is it that they feel? What are the experiences that they want to have? Then what are your critical insights based on that? And based on the insights, you will draw a sort of bottle and give up the information. So again, I am showing you the empathy map. You need to make this empathy map. What that customer said, what the customer did, what the customer felt and thought. Now this will help you in a big way how to go about it. Now is filling up of the empathy map template. It is based on your interview. You will make that empathy map template I just showed. Then basically identify the need based on 4 aspects. Again, the same template. And then having that as what you are going to do is make the POV. And that is, who is the user? Define it. What is the need? And what are your critical insights? So, this could be user is an on-the-go salesperson. What is the need? What is the insight? And then from that, you will form the HMB. How might we design the bottle so that need of the customer is fit? Now, right now, because we are not into prototyping, what we would want you to do is make a sort of a sketch or something of that, or you can 3D design if you are all engineering students, quite a few. So maybe a 3D design of what you want, and you can share it And what I can do is then, based on whatever you have done, what you designs, if I find some excellent designs, I can share it back with your institute and they can, in a formal way or whichever way, you know, disseminate amongst all of you, okay, how that works. So what are the requirements? I need only 4 slides from you. By each of you, I mean either each of you or your team. If you have a study group, then your study group, whichever way, I leave it to the management, how they want to do it. So slide 1, I want you to make an empathy map. So there has to be a customer. You will make an empathy map with that customer. Then is the point of view. You will make a point of view. You already seen the format of the point of view, right? So you will write the complete point of view for me. And then how might we, HMV, right? That is what you will make. And slide number 4 would be the ideas for the product, maybe in a sketch, or maybe, as I said, a 3D print of that, or a bullet points, whichever way. And you can email it to me at this. I have given you my email ID. And based on that, I will give it back to Ms. Neha. And she is going to then maybe, you know, my comments and everything, it can be disseminated, right? So that is how I wish to suggest. So maybe what I'm giving you a very brief idea what it can be, like what can be the user. He's mostly traveling, needs to drink water at all the times, wherever that person may be, right? What is the need? Easy to use bottle, maybe drinking one-handed, right? Because in the other hand, imagine a salesperson who is traveling, who is in a bus, who is on a, maybe taxi, maybe in a train. One hand is on the mobile where he is communicating with his customers and others, trying to reach and meet them. And on the other hand, he has a water. I mean, he's feeling parched. He need to have water. How will you use the bottle? I mean, with one-handedly. So what then? What could be a better measure for disposal of these? I'm just giving you some hints. How can you design a bottle which can, you can self, you can destroy it and then put it? You know, if you are traveling in Shatabdi or in aircraft or wherever, there are so many announcements made that please crush the bottle before you, because somebody else may use the bottle. Then what could be the right size of the bottle? How do you want to carry? How will you grip the bottle? There are a number of other aspects also which I have not highlighted, right? I want you to come out with that. You should be able to do, you know, what I can also show you is something with the previous group that I had done. I will just show you, one sec. That can, okay. Okay. Sorry, I'll come back to this. Okay, so this is a open-minded office goer. So don't read the word salesperson. It is on, this was a, by mistake I've got this here, but it is supposed to be a modern office-going woman. So she's, so she was to design a bag. She's an office goer, needs to impress, wants to carry things differently. What is the need? Lightweight, multi-purpose, weatherproof bag that she wants to carry. What could be the insight? This is invisible till used. See, the point is it should be invisible till used. It could be put in a bag or something. When used, it should be good looking, sophisticated. Social acceptance should be a must. It should be eco-friendly. It should have some, you know, some very good, maybe something written on it, which is a reflection of the person who is carrying it, and so on. So this is just to give you an example how things are. So one of the thoughts were, the bags to hold umbrella as well as a purse, bags to have a message unique to the user, a backpack slung on hand, should it have wheels? What could be the material? Should it be environmental friendly? Should it have multiple pockets? Should it be biodegradable? What could be a security angle? So these are some examples that I am giving you, but you have to work out on your own, right? So any questions on the assignment that I have given you so far? Anyone? Yeah, so somebody has said there was an example of mineral water bottles. Why can't the bottle cap be shifted slightly downwards and so on? I mean, it's up to you what you want to do, right? So this was by Manya. So this is Manya. You have to work on this. Yeah. Then another question was, as Mrityunjay sir said, that you face budget and time constraints. Then how do you reconcile your ideation according to that? So this has been asked by Akanksha. So Akanksha, you got it other way around. Right. So you first do your ideation and then you do your budget and time constraints. Because what happens is, if you can do an ideation in the right way, and so you have come at some product which may be costing more than what your budget was. Now you have number of options. Either you convince the management or whatever that yes, the ROI is going to be much better, return on investment. Or what you can do is maybe consider that could be another form of innovation, how the prices could be, the cost could be reduced. Reduction of cost, there are a number of measures by which you can reduce cost. But what I'm trying to say is, if you take the constraint first of reducing cost, then maybe you will kill a number of ideas, right? So that is how this works. Ideal number of customers for feedback. I'll come to that. That is, I'm going ahead with that. I will cover in a short while. Any other questions? Somebody has asked, can we get this PPT? So this is being recorded, as I can see. So you can reach your management. They can definitely help you with that. Okay. Any other questions? Or we move ahead. I think we are also losing out on time. So let me go ahead.
So we can move ahead with it.
Yeah. Okay, so next we come to the aspect of prototyping, right? Prototype is very important. It is now from flair, you are coming back to focus, all right? Prototyping is all about getting ideas and explorations out of your head and into the physical world. So prototyping is where the rubber hits the road, as we say. That is the time where you are now coming off from your high horse and you are coming to start designing things. And a prototype can be in any form, let me tell you. It can be a physical form. It can be just post-it notes for all you know, right? It could be a role-playing activity. It can be a story. It can be a role-playing activity that you do for a process or whatever. It could be a space. It can be an object, interface, or even a storyboard. Stories are a very powerful medium of prototyping. See, stories answer all the three questions of what, how, why. All the details are made available. So if it is a process, maybe some stories can work. If it is a product, maybe you can use some clay to make some, use a form of clay or any other, other toys. Anything can be used for getting there. But one important aspect of prototyping is that you should do so much of prototyping that if you have to fail, you should fail earlier than later. And you should test often. Why I am saying that? There are so many cases of cars being recalled for maintenance, for faulty design. All right? If a car imagine a car is recalled after being sold for a faulty design, the amount of money that is gone, the impact on the reputation of that company that they have. And the advantage to the competitors. So try and make your prototype such at the earliest stage that whatever failures are to be there, they are achieved in that time, at the earliest possible time. And then you should test as often as possible. Don't be afraid of testing. Keep testing, keep getting feedback. So somebody had asked that, is there a number of customers for feedback purposes? No, nothing like that. The more the customers, the better it is for you. Of course, it should not go, so much beyond that you never land into the testing phase. Huh? It should not happen. Again, excess is bad. Nothing should be excess. It should be you have to use your judgment to be at the right figures. Now, next we come to from prototype is something that is very narrow. Focused is testing. Testing is the last stage before you go into production. Right? And in testing, you are obtaining feedback of your solutions, you are refining your solutions, and you are making them much better. And you continue to learn about your users. So testing is something which is a very essential part, and quite often people are so overconfident by the time that they reach the testing stage that they miss out on this golden opportunity to make their product better, right? You should prototype. The golden rule is that you should prototype as if you know you are right, but test as if you know you are wrong. It's a very important statement. I'm repeating it for you. Prototype as if you know you are right, but test as if you know that you are wrong. And in, again, testing, don't try to sell the product. Don't try to, you know, say, yaar, bahut achha sir, le lo aap, very good. And then take this genuine feedback. Don't go to your mom and say, mom, maine ye bataya. My mom bole ki, mera beta to yaar bahut achha hai, usse ta achha koi hai hi nahi. So, tune jo bhi banaya beta, ye bahut achha hai. Or you go to your dad and say, dad, I have made this. Dad will say, beta, I'm proud of you. Go ahead. They are not the right people. Or maybe even your friends. Oh, friends will pull you down. Achha, tum itna uncha chala gaya kya product bana ke hame dikha raha hai. And so you have to reach out to the right clientele for testing. Now that is extremely important. And testing of a product helps you overcome so many problems in the real product. It's a fact of life. So whenever you reach that stage, like even say this bottle of mineral water that you are designing, and maybe you start making that bottle, you should circulate it amongst all variety of people, and mostly, if possible, with the extreme user. Give it to the extreme user and you will get a genuine feedback which is applicable to everyone. Always try and go for the extreme user, and that makes a huge difference there. So there are certain very good books which are available, where if I have been able to, you know, trigger your imagination, and you wish to further read about this thing. So yeah, are you solving the right problems? That is by the Harvard Defense HBR, Harvard Business Review, and this is by Thomas Wedel, and Wedel is Borg. Very nice. You can Google it and see, and you can search it out. Then another very nice one is the Design Thinking Toolbox. This is a guide to mastering the most popular and valuable innovation methods. See, what happens in this is, especially in design thinking, in these workshops, they are very, very innovative workshops that you can get. I mean, unfortunately, at this time, we have not been able to do a workshop. Maybe sometime later, when the situation which will improve and we can physically interact with each other, you will find that it is a what an experience it can be, where you can in groups sit and work on things, everyday things that you can improve, everyday processes you can physically see, check and improve, and have that pleasure of seeing that how others are happy when they are using it. Then another one is Jobs to be Done. Now this Jobs to be Done is a very nice, it's a full book, Theory to Practice by Anthony W. Ulvik. So there are a number of, Jobs to be Done is all about how you can on the go work and bring in changes in the products that you are using day to day. Very interesting insights. I would strongly recommend people to go for this book as and when it is feasible for you people. Then there are a number of websites also which are there, large number of websites which can teach you. Let me tell you, but that's Stanford is one of the leading organizations, universities, which teach you about design thinking. And today, if you become a design thinker, right, I mean that if you take on the necessary education in this area and you get the necessary certification in this area, then a design thinker is going to be used more and more. Your career is going to be becoming more and more important in new product design. And not only that, in the marketing field also, because the social media is becoming more and more popular and important for any company. And in social media, design thinking is a very important role to play. Even the new product design, you would have noticed, if I'm not sure, in your studies, that today, all products are becoming more and more customer-centric. Every product is about customers. What will the customer want? How does he want? And so it is about inside-out thinking rather than outside-in. See, earlier it used to be that, suppose XYZ company that says that I have made a laptop. It has these specifications, right? And if you want, this is available to you. Otherwise, thank you. So this is outside-in. You have made, based on your understanding, you have designed the product. You have the specifications of the laptop. And you are asking these guys who are there, the customers, that you like it or leave it. My way or highway, right? So that was what was there earlier. But now things have changed. What you do is inside out. You first go to the customer. You ask the customer, right? What do you want? What are your needs? What are you looking forward to? And once that customer gives you the details, then you design a product which the customer really needs. All right? And once you design that product, it sells well. The experience that the UI and the UX that we talk about, right? The UX and the UI are far better in these products, right? So that is how the design thinking is changing the ways. So you as a career, you can, if you have liked this idea and you think that it can titillate your imagination, if you think that, yes, you can empathize well with the customers, if you think that you are able to, you know, based on the interviews, the insights, if you can get the real needs of the customer, and if you think you can make a nice HMV, how might we question, and if you have a very dedicated team, that team you can work with, you can come up with some prototypes, some solutions, and test them, and there is no end to this. So all the good companies of today, they are into designing new products which are customer-centric. Customer-centricity is the order of the day today, and I think in the near future, it is going to be that. And wherever there is customer-centricity, there is design. So there is a huge opportunity for you in this. And with this, I really wish to thank you. This is my email ID. This is my mobile number. I'm sorry I had to reduce this, otherwise the real fun is in the workshop and the presentations made by the teams, because that is where really there are great learnings that we have. This time we have not been able to do that, but this is not the end of the world. And going ahead, let us see if there are opportunities where we can work together. But I do hope that you, as mostly as students, I have been able to generate that feeling of happiness, that feeling of desire to learn more about design thinking. And as I said, that 65% of you didn't know about it. I wanted to reverse it. And more often, more people who thought that design thinking is difficult, you will find that it is better. So yeah, thank you very much. With this, I end. In case there are any questions, you please. So. There is a question by Shivang Dwivedi. How do we measure the success of a design thinking initiative? I think, Shivang, you can answer this. I think you can answer it. How do we measure the success? The success is, if the customer is happy, you are happy. Right? That is the success. Basically, it is all about the needs of a customer. Right? Any other question before we end? I do hope you have liked it, and thank you. Over to Dr.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Neha, yeah. You are there.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. I think it's been a wonderful session. It is indeed my great pleasure, sir, to extend my heartfelt gratitude to you for kindly consenting and addressing our students on this unique process of innovating through design thinking, something that is usually accepted in the industry and is being adopted by so many companies like Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, and Google. And not just that, but these schools around the world are using this concept and they are inculcating that spirit of entrepreneurship and innovation and creativity amongst their students through this. I'm sure that students must have had a learning experience and hope that this session will help our students and they are going to continue to innovate and develop something innovative, understanding the needs of the customer. Surely, sir, we would love to have you in our campus sometime when things get normal and do it in the form of workshop. That will be really great. And my sincere thanks to Startup Punjab team for giving us the opportunity to host this session. And we hope to continue the association with Startup Punjab and continue with the partnership. And thank you all the participants for being patient listeners. Thank you, Director Sir. Thank you all the faculty members and all participants from within the campus, from APJ Institute, as well as from outside who have joined us today. And stay safe and have a good day.
Thank you so much, sir. So thank you once again, sir, for joining with us. And definitely the thought-provoking, the ideas or the tips which you have given to all of our students as well as to the faculty. Definitely, I think now in future, they will start doing some of their activities in such a way that they try to find out some of the innovations. Now, my request to all the students means, I know you people are regular user of social media, Instagram, or Facebook, LinkedIn, etc. When you keep scrolling, you can find out lot of ideas coming out. Even for example, when we talk about even how lighting a lamp or something like dhoof, agarbatti, etc. So you can find out lot of designs coming up on daily basis. So what is it? It is basically the thinking of design and then putting that creativity into picture. So now start observing onwards. Now onwards, start observing lot of stuff, lot of changes being made by different companies in their products as well as in their services. Definitely, this is only the way you can ignite and you can go for logical reasoning ki how or what kind of innovations these are being required. Just like Manya, I think, mentioned about the mineral water bottle is how it will be the down trend. Like this, so a lot of activities you can consider and definitely will be useful for you. So once again, sir, thank you so much, Rajivji, for such a insightfulness into this idea, design thinking. And I'm really grateful to the Punjab Startup, Sunil Chawlaji and Salil Kaplashi. Thank you so much for joining with us. Thank you once again. And definitely, as stated by Neha, we would love to have you in our campus in a form of workshop or something like this. And definitely, in future, I think that will be possible. Thank you so much, sir.
I thank you for the opportunity. And it has been a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.